But do you remember the first name of Cassidy's, the name?
Hopalong.
Hopalong. That first film, actually, they spelt it Hopalong with two hyphens.
That's right.
Which they dropped. Do you remember the name of the actor who played it?
Bill Boyd.
Right. Now, can you dispose of the rumour that you were once in the running for that part?
I can dispose of it. I was not... Well, what happened was, I was still an extra, one of 22,000, incidentally, looking for 800 jobs every day, and I got myself an agent called Bill Schifrin. And Bill Schifrin took me to see a producer called Pop Sherman, who was just starting a movie. And I was wheeled in front of him, and I was young and sort of fairly thin and everything. And he said, "Hey, you look great. Where are you from?" And I said, "London, England." He said, "Get out!" and this was Hopalong Cassidy. I was in the British Army, and we were stuck for a while in Richmond Park. The whole of our strange outfit was brought in from various parts of England to be given extra training in something. Anyway, and so the colonel said to me, he used to call me Newman a great deal, but he said, "Newman, he said, you were an actor, you were an actor, so will you get up a concert for the men?" And I'm just hopeless at that sort of thing. So I ran to Sid, and I said, "Help, for God's sake, what can you..." He said, "Oh, leave it to me." And he said, "Go and ask Bud." So I went and saw Bud Flanagan, and the whole lot arrived.
Oh, great.
Bud Flanagan, Chesney Allen, of course, Nervo Knox, Norton Wayne, Leslie Henson, Sid Field, DeBroy Summers and his entire band, Teddy Brown and his xylophone.
That's not a bad troop concert, you know,
and they came,
is it?
And they said, "The only thing is, you provide transport." It was very difficult, obviously. Yeah. So I got two double-decker buses, and the whole lot arrived down in Richmond in the buses at, like, midnight, because after their shows. Yeah. Arthur Risco, Francis Day, it was endless. The show went on for about 4 hours in a huge cinema in Richmond. And the colonel was a wonderful little man. He got killed later. He was a wonderful little man. And so he produced food in the officer's mess for them. And I'll never forget this performance. Jimmy Nervo said that the colonel was handing around some sandwiches with a horrid little flag with sardine written on it, you know? So Jimmy Nervo said, have a sandwich. Oh, he said, "Thanks very much," and he ate the flag. brushed the sandwiches onto the floor and hit the colonel over the head with a plate. And that was, he said, "Oh, Niven, very peculiar friends, I got all that stuff."
Now, you did two memorable films with Errol Flynn. Can you remind us of the name?
Well, Charge of the Light Brigade, originally, and then Dawn Patrol.
Yeah. As regards Errol Flynn, you absolutely shattered my illusions about him by something you said in your book. You said he used to bite his nails.
Oh, he did, to the elbow, yes.
Really?
I knew Errol very well. We shared a house together for 2 years, and occasionally used to enlist me to spar with him of these things, too.
Yeah.
But he did, he bit his nails. He was nervous.
That's funny, isn't it? Because my mother always said, "Don't bite your nails or you'll grow up like..." So I was saying, "Don't bite your nails or you'll grow up like Errol Flynn." No threat at all. In your role as the girl-shy, kiss-shy musical genius, you were a concert pianist. Now how did you actually get away with playing the piano in the scene?
I played Bonnie Dundee with two fingers, I can do that.
Yeah.
But they had a big pianist man who sat behind me with his arms through my coat.
it's a jolly good job you weren't doing tap dance.
Yeah. I had to make the faces, though, do all that.
Well, The Bishop's Wife, that was a nice film. That
was a rather good movie. That was.
Yeah. Anything in the making of that comes back? Because that was one where you really played a rather old man, didn't you?
Played the bishop, in fact.
Yeah. Mm.
Well, yes, he wasn't all that old, a bishop, but I do remember one thing, because the director took against Loretta and also took against Cary Grant, who was playing the angel. Mm. And he did a terrible thing. He said, "Do you know the old music hall trick of the man in the middle?" And I did know it. And they were playing a long scene, talking to each other. He said, "If I put you in the middle, will you do it?" And I said, "If you'll let me." and it's this. So imagine this is one person talking, and here's the other one, and you're in the middle. The trick is, you're not speaking, you just look at the one who's always finished speaking. and you don't have to say a word, you see. So they go... it's absolutely infallible.
Oh, that'll run through every rep country in the country to... besides Cagney, were there any other people for whom you had this great admiration that you regret not having worked with?
Oh, dozens, really dozens. Yeah. I mean, I never worked with even friends of mine, like Gable, I never worked with him or Bogey.
Mm.
Oh, dozens of them.
Well, as we started with how you didn't get to play the part of Hopalong Cassidy, let's recall some of the other roles that you mentioned having missed out on. Now,
Lost Horizon.
Yeah.
Yeah, Lost Horizon.
And you lost out the horizon.
Well, I was hoping to get a test for it. And Frank Capra was the great director in those days. And there was a chance I might get this test. And it didn't happen at all.
Well, for an extra nostalgia point, can you remember who did play the part of the brother?
John Howard.
John, that you nearly got at one time.
Well, I know when the end comes of this, it'll be a sort of laugh. Mm. It's not meant that way. What happened was that Bette Davis was going to play the picture for Warner Brothers, and I was borrowed with great excitement for myself from Samuel Goldwyn to play the rat, the Cockney River rat. And I went to great trouble and grew a beard, a ratty looking beard, and polished up the Cockney and everything. And then Bette Davis decided at the last minute that she could not be photographed out of doors. So the picture was cancelled, and 14 years later, John Huston found it lying around in Warner Brothers, and they made this classic, of course, with Bogey and Katie Hepburn. And one day, I uncorked this to Bogey, who was a great friend of mine. I thought I'd just tell him, you know, he was going on about his famous roles and everything. I said, you're very lucky to have that one, by the way. Somebody else nearly got it, you know. I told him this little story, and I waited for the explosion. But he was so great, Bogey, and understood so much, you know. First of all, he put his arm around my shoulders, knowing what an awful blow it must have been to lose it, and said, kid, you'd have stunk up the screen.
That's something in 79 pictures you haven't danced.